Well, as I, over the last month, have had the opportunity to ask people to pray for them, maybe people who maybe aren't Christians but are open to prayer, quite often the response that I have heard, certainly to a greater degree in the last month, and you probably won't be surprised by this, is people asking to pray for peace in our world, especially with what's happened in Israel over the last year or last month. People have been heartbroken by that, as we have, and they have looked out and they have said, would you pray for peace in our world? Would you pray for peace? And I'm certainly more than glad to accommodate and pray that prayer. But as I have prayed that and done that, in moments I've thought this, if God was to answer every prayer I would pray right now for these world situations of war and conflict that can be so discouraging, if God was to answer every prayer, then what would I actually pray? What am I really looking for God to do in these moments? And if you start thinking about it in those terms, you see what's going on in our world, and you know there are no simple solutions. Like, you know, what really is the answer for long-term conflict, for long-term war and disagreement and so much going on? What do we actually pray? What do we actually want God to do? And if you go down too far down that road, you can get a little bit hopeless, a little bit discouraged. Is there any hope for our world? Well, in some ways, the character we're going to look at today in Scripture, Daniel, is in a very similar spot. He's looking back on what's happened to his nation, the nation of Israel, and it has been conquered by another nation. His capital city, Jerusalem, in rubble, the temple destroyed, and Daniel is looking back and feeling the pain of that and the loss of that, and he's praying, God, would you restore our city? Would you restore the temple? Would you bring us back? And I think even in Daniel's mind, he knows he wants him to do that. He knows that's not the full solution. He just wants to get back to his country and get his temple reestablished and the city walls built. But Daniel's probably feeling much the same we are as we pray for different world situations. God, are you really going to fix everything? Because he knows if he goes back to Jerusalem, there's still going to be war and there's still going to be conflict. And yet as Daniel's praying this prayer that we looked at last week, now we come to the second half of chapter 9 where God answers the prayer. And he says, Daniel, I'm going to do more than you could ever imagine. I'm going to fix everything. Here's the ultimate answer to your prayer and to our prayer for peace on the earth. God just says, here's the final picture, and he gives it to Daniel as a way of putting hope into Daniel's soul. To say, Daniel, I'm hearing and I'm seeing the devastation of your country and your nation, and here's where you can place your hope. You can be sure this is what the future holds. And so we have the great privilege this morning of coming and looking in on what God gave Daniel there in chapter 9, where Daniel finds hope and where we can find hope today in the midst of everything that's going on in our world. And that's my prayer today. May we see Daniel's vision. May we see what he sees, and may we know that is the hope. That is where that's our foundation for hope, no matter what is happening in our lives. So it's Daniel chapter 9. I sure hope you have your Bibles to open them up, turn them on, follow along with me. It's so important that you can just see these words in Scripture yourself and mark or highlight them in your own Bibles. As you're finding that, let me just introduce myself. My name is Jeff Bennett. Privilege of being the lead pastor here, and Harbor Online, just welcome to you, whether you're watching now or at a later time. Just praying you'll be strengthened this morning. You'll be encouraged in the ultimate hope that we have. So hopefully you found that passage there. Let me just read it for you. We're down. Last week we did the first half. Today we're starting in Daniel was praying. Now we're going to start in verse 20 and go through to verse 27, the answer to prayer, how God responds to his prayer. Follow along with me as I read. While I was speaking and praying, confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel, and making my request to the Lord my God for his holy hill, while I was still in prayer, Gabriel, the man I had seen in the earlier vision, came to me in swift flight about the time of the evening sacrifice. He instructed me and said to me, Daniel, I have now come to give you insight and understanding. As soon as you began to pray, a word went out, which I have come to tell you, for you are highly esteemed, therefore consider the word and understand the vision. And here's the answer, here's the vision. 77s are decreed for your people, and your holy city to finish the transgression, to put an end to sin, to atone for wickedness, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy place. No one understand this. From the time the word goes out to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until the anointed one, the ruler, comes, there will be seven sevens and then 62 sevens. It will be rebuilt with streets and a trench, but in times of trouble. But after the 62 sevens, the anointed one will be put to death and will have nothing. The people of the ruler will come and will destroy the city and sanctuary. The end will come like a flood. War will continue until the end, and desolations have been decreed. He will confirm a covenant with many for 1 7. In the middle of the seven, he will put an end to the sacrifice and offering, and at the temple he will set up an abomination that causes desolation until the end that is decreed is poured out on him. And this is the word of the Lord. Let me offer a brief prayer. God, we look into your word, and God, we pray, Lord, that you would help us to understand. And God, I pray, Lord, you would help me, Lord, to speak clearly your words today. And we ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. What I have just read for you is one of the core passages in the Bible about biblical prophecy. As we look to the end of time, you're going to end up sometime in Daniel 9, these verses. It is absolutely a core passage, and as you might have read, it's a little bit of a confusing passage. We're going to have to do a little bit of math and work our way through it here today. But what God is giving Daniel is a picture of the end. He's giving him a picture of the end, and this is our third message in a series as we're looking at Daniel's prophecies, Daniel's picture of the future for us. And so this is God saying to us, here's what the future holds. Here's what the end of the age looks like. Here's what the return of Christ looks like, and here's what happens after that. Here's our ultimate hope. So what I'm going to do here in the first bit is just walk through this passage real slowly so you can get a sense of it. I've just titled the first half of this message, The Timing of the End. We're going to look at the timing. Daniel's giving us some specifics there. Then after we've worked through that, sort of hold on as we do some math and go through there, then we're going to go to the New Testament and say, if this is the picture of the end, how do we prepare for that? What should we know? How should we prepare well? And then lastly, where I started, we want to end with the hope of the end. What's the hope in here? So as we go through this, you might feel like, oh, this is really weighty. Is there any hope? Yes, hold on to the end. We get to the hope, and it's a wonderful picture. So let me just walk through these verses here just so we can understand this vision that Daniel gets. In verses 20 through 23, Daniel gets the answer to prayer. The angel Gabriel comes and delivers this vision. It's a fascinating three verses. It happens again in chapter 10, so I'm not avoiding any of the conversation. We'll just deal with that next week as we see a similar incident. So then we go down to verse 24. Remember, this is the timing of the end. Daniel's praying for restoration of the kingdom and of his city. And verse 24 starts this way. 70 sevens are decreed for your people and for your holy city. What does that mean? 70 sevens. In some of your Bibles, it may say 70 weeks. If your Bible says 70 weeks, what we think of as a week is a group of 7 days. Week is basically a grouping of seven. In this case, it's not a grouping of days, it's a grouping of years. That's why the NIV translates it sevens. So it's 70 sevens, meaning 70 groups of 70 years. So if you're doing your math, 70 times 7 is 490 years. Daniel's, what the vision is there's 490 years, these 70 sevens. And then the rest of verse 24 is what happens at the end of the last seven. The end of it all, that's the hope that we're going to return to. I've already read it, but we'll come at the beginning. Here's the end picture, and here's what it all means. It's a glorious picture. But now in verse 25, we get these, at the end of the 77s, from verse 25 on, we're going to see the breakup of how these sevens, these years, unfold. So verse 25, no one understand this. From the time the word goes out to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until the anointed ruler comes. So now we've got two bookmarks there. First bookmark, from the word goes out to restore Jerusalem, rebuild the temple, till the time the anointed one comes. That's Jesus. Two bookmarks here. Now he's going to give us the timing. How much time in between those two things? There will be 7 sevens and 62 sevens. I won't talk about why they're divided up, but 7 plus 62 is 69. Told you a little math. Hang on. Promise. This is about as bad as it gets right here. 69 sevens. 69 sevens from when? From when the temple is decreed to be rebuilt. That's Artaxerxes in about 445 BC to the time of Christ. That's about 483 years that Nehemiah is prophesying here. From the time the temple in Nehemiah 2 gets declared to be rebuilt to the time of Christ, about 69 sevens. Now, some of you, if you know when that temple restoration happened, probably around 455 BC, if we're right, and you can start doing the math in your head and saying, how did Daniel do? Did he get this prophecy right? And even in your head, you're saying he came pretty close to that. So as we look at these numbers, how do we interpret this? How do we interpret that? There's two ways. One is, and I have a book on my office shelf that I had to read in Bible school at Moody, where an author has looked at those two dates and says from the time Artaxerxes made the declaration to the time Christ comes on Palm Sunday is exactly 483 years. He did some research, and again, how long are years and you know, leap years and all of these things. It's quite a complicated book, and he says it's exactly right. Now, do I think he's right? I'm not so sure. He may get an A on that book when he gets to heaven and meets Jesus for his good research in that regard. But here's the point here. Whether it's exactly right or not, it's really close. And here's what we would say. As we read these 69 sevens, it's written in a way, it's not an allegory. So we know there's some literalness to this. It's a literal number. But sometimes when we read numbers in the Bible, we can call them this, symbolic approximations. Really, Daniel is getting a vision of a time period from here to here. It could be exactly right. And if it is, we would praise God for that. But even if it's not, even if we don't want to do all that work, the point is that Daniel is giving us a prophecy of these 69 sevens from the temple rebuilt to here. And he's getting it, and the prophecy is really accurate. Let me just talk a little bit about symbolic approximations. We do it all the time. Some of you to say to me, Jeff, I hear you're going to West Africa, to the country of Guinea, and you're going to go there and train pastors and take a team of 9 others with you. And I'd say, yeah, that's true. And you said, well, when are you going? And I said, well, I'm going in 2 months. And you went home and checked your calendar and the dates, and you came back to me and said, Jeff, you're actually not going in 2 months. You're going in 2 months, 7 days, and 6 hours. And I would say to you, I'm going in 2 months, okay? Just relax, right? It's close enough. It's close enough. It's an approximation. We all would understand what that meant. Here is, as time goes out, we do more approximations. Some of you, sorry about this, if you're born in the 1940s, some of you get asked, hey, when were you born? And here's what you say. I was born in the 40s. You just give a whole decade for your birthday, right? You're not even giving a specific a month, a year. You're just like, I was born in the 40s. You're just saying, I'm old. It doesn't really matter. I was born in the 1940s. Right? Sorry, I said it. Right? It's an approximation, and we all know exactly what you're saying. In many ways, Daniel's saying here, 69 sevens, from the time Artaxerxes to the time of Christ. And then, look what he says next. During that time, Jerusalem will be rebuilt with its streets. There will be a trench around the outside, and there'll be times of trouble. And we know that was exactly true through history. This is what Daniel had been praying. May Jerusalem be restored. And the prophecy says it will be restored. And we know in the time of Jesus, Jerusalem is operating. There was certainly trouble. The Romans are occupying it. There's a trench around the outside. All of this is true. Then look down to verse 26. After the 62 sevens, you remember there were 7 and 62. So after the 69 sevens, what's going to happen next? The anointed one will be put to death and will have nothing. Isn't this fascinating? Hundreds of years before the coming of Christ, what does Daniel write? The anointed one will come about this time, and he does. And then what does Daniel write? The anointed one will be put to death and have nothing. And we think of Christ on the cross, crucified with nothing, just as Daniel predicted it. If you're a skeptic about the Bible, these fulfilled prophecies, we see hundreds of them in Scripture. In regards to these things, this is just one of so many examples. Then after the 69 sevens, you're like, Daniel, what happened to the last 7? He hasn't got to it yet. But look down. After that, after the anointed one is put to death, the people of the ruler will come, will destroy the city and the sanctuary. So Daniel says there's this other ruler. He's got some people. What are they going to do? They're not good people. They come and destroy the city of Jerusalem and the sanctuary. We know this happened in history. AD 70, Titus, under the Roman occupation, comes in and destroys this. Jesus predicted this as well. And then, after the destruction of the temple, what happens next? Daniel, what about the last seven? Not yet. War will continue until the end. After AD 70, destruction of the temple, what happens next? War will continue to the end. Have we got to the end yet? No. What are we seeing? War is continuing. We're seeing this today. War continues to the end. Daniel, what about the last seven? There's a gap here between the 69th seven and the 70th seven. This often happens in Scripture. It's called a prophetic gap. We've talked about being two mountain peaks. In the book of Isaiah, let me give you another gap. Here's an Isaiah prophecy about Jesus. Unto us a child is born. Unto us a son is given. You know that prophecy, right? It's Christmas. It's wonderful. It's a great prophecy. But you know how it ends? And the government shall rest upon his shoulders. There's a gap there, isn't it? We don't see a literal government with Jesus reigning. Daniel, Isaiah said it all together, but there's a gap in fulfillment. Same here in Daniel. We've got a gap between the 69th seven and the final seven. Now in verse 27, here comes the final seven. He will confirm a covenant with many for 1 7. There it is, the last 7 year period. Who's the he? It refers to the ruler, the prince, the little horn that we've talked about the previous weeks. 2 weeks ago, I talked about him as the Antichrist. This little horn, this Antichrist, this ruler will come, and what's he going to do? Confirm a covenant for 7 years, for 1 7. So the Antichrist steps on the scene, and he says, I'm going to guarantee peace for the people of God for a 7 year period. But then, next sentence, what happens? In the middle of the seven, 3.5 years in, what's he going to do? He's going to put an end to the sacrifice and the offering. He's going to stop all the worship of God. And at the temple, he will set up an abomination that causes desolation. Right at the midpoint, there's going to be this thing that's called the abomination of desolation. And then, what's the last part of the verse? All that will happen until the end that is decreed, poured out on him. At the end of that time, this Antichrist is judge. So that's what Daniel is giving us, a picture of the end. Let me just put up on the side screen sort of my summary overview of where we have been going, and let me just give this summary here of what precedes the end of the age. We've taught through Daniel 7, 8, and 9, and this has been my summary. How do we know when the end is coming? Three things. A global kingdom led by the Antichrist. We see some of that in here. He's got this global kingdom. He's guaranteeing protection for God's people. But then in the middle half, there's this great double cross, this abomination of desolation, which leads to a severe persecution of God's people. We talked about that. And then my third point, which I wanted to come to today, for a limited time. How long is this time period? It's half of the seven, 3.5 years. If you remember back to Daniel 7, and I conveniently skipped it, I'll come back to it now. Daniel gives us another time frame, another symbolic approximation for this time. He says it this way, the holy people will be delivered into the Antichrist's hands for a time, times, and half a time. Daniel says it that way, times, plural, and a half a time. Time is a year. One time times 2 years, half a time. So 1 + 2 + 1/2 is 3.5 years. Same prophecy. Limited time. So Daniel's looking forward here. He's saying, what precedes the end of the age? And he's filling in these pictures for us in chapters 7, 8, and 9. Global kingdom led by the Antichrist, who has this severe persecution on God's people, but it's only for this limited time, half of this 7 week, this 7-7 period. You may say, well, Jeff, how do you know this? Like, this could mean so many different things. How do we understand this? How can we be sure of these things? Well, if we go to the New Testament, Jesus looks back on this passage. Jesus knows this is a core passage. Again, just like we do. So Jesus actually refers back to it, and you're going to see that come up on the side screens here. This passage, here's as Jesus talks about the timing of the end. Look how he states this. He's going to interpret this passage for us. You don't have to, we can just look at what he says. So when you see standing in the holy place the abomination that causes desolation spoken of through the prophet Daniel, let the reader understand. So Jesus goes back to this, saying this is such an important event. He's answering the question in Matthew 24, how do we know what the end of the age looks like? Jesus says, here's the sign. When you see this, the Antichrist, have this abomination of desolation at the halfway point through this last seven, that's the sign. And then look what he says. This is where it gets discouraging. Let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let no one on the housetops go down to take anything out of the house. Let no one in the field go back to their cloak. How dreadful it will be in those days for pregnant women and nursing mothers. Pray that your flight will not take place in winter on the Sabbath. For there will be great distress unequaled from the beginning of the world until now and never to be equaled again. Jesus is saying, when you see this sign, the end of the age is coming, and run for the hills because the people of God are going to experience this severe persecution that has never been seen before on the earth. That's the picture that Jesus gives us. And that's where Daniel ends. That's it. That's the last verse. That's the picture he gives. Now, in a moment, we're going to go back up to verse 24 because this is not very hopeful right now. But we'll go back to verse 24 and see the end picture, the hope picture. But as we just pause now and think about this, if these are the signs of the end of the age, that there will be an Antichrist come, there'll be a global kingdom, there'll be this abomination of desolation halfway through, these are the signs, there'll be this severe persecution. Paul talks about this in Thessalonians, a great falling away because there's so much persecution. But the good news is it's just for a limited time. What does the New Testament tell us about how we should prepare? How should we prepare for this? How do we process this? And let me just give three main ideas of how we prepare for this as the followers of God, as reading these words. You'll see on the screen here the first idea. We prepare by being alert, but not alarmed. We prepare by being alert, not alarmed. Let me read the verse there. Jesus answered, "Watch out that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name, claiming I am the Messiah, and will deceive many. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these things are the beginning of the birth pains." So Jesus now looks in and he says, let me just give you a picture. There's going to be wars and rumors of wars. There's going to be famines and earthquakes. What does he say when we see those things? He says it right there. Don't be alarmed. Don't be alarmed. He says, those things must happen. I have a plan in all of these things. In every war, in every famine, every earthquake, he's saying, I have a plan. I'm in total control. But the end is still to come. Those things are not the sign of the end. Those things are still to come. Jesus has told us what the signs of the end are, which is the things we've talked about, the Antichrist, the abomination of desolation, the global kingdom. These things are not the sign of the end. Here's what he says. They're just the beginning of birth pains. They remind us that the end is coming. And this is what Daniel has said. From the moment the fall of Jerusalem, Daniel says, wars are going to continue to the end. We're like, yes, we know that. We've seen it. They're like birth pains. They remind us that the end is coming. We've been in a 2,000-year period of sensing an earthquake, a famine, a war, reminding ourselves that the end is coming. And sometimes, just like birth pains, they're more, a little more extreme, but then they subside. And then they come back again, and we certainly, depending on how old you live, have known how these things have come in seasons like birth pains. Just because things are bad does not mean that Christ is going to return. In fact, Jesus says here, things are going to be bad, but remember, I'm in control, and these are just the birth pains, but don't be alarmed, but be alert for the signs that I have given you. Last year, I sort of studied through the book of Daniel and then studied through the book of Revelation and tried to prepare my best I could. I knew this series was coming and wanted to be able to sort of ground myself in these matters and really enjoy that. And then this summer, John Piper came out with a book, and some of you know me, John Piper, called Come, Lord Jesus. Wonderful book. And he came out with the book, and I was a little bit nervous to read it over my summer break because I thought, if he's got a really great argument that's different than what I have discovered in Scripture, this is going to really, you know, confuse everything in my mind for me. But I read it anyway, and I want to say it this way, but this isn't a very good way to say it. John Piper really agrees with me on all these things. That would be incorrect. John Piper and I did our own study individually, and we have arrived very much in the same place. And I have been highlighting this book in Harbor Happenings. You can get a free download of it and read through it. It's a devotional book, 20-something days, a wonderful book to read through that just helps our hearts long for the coming of the Lord Jesus. But as he talks about this issue of knowing when Christ might come and the immediacy of it, here's how he reads it. You see the quote there. Therefore, combining how short the time may be from any given moment in history until the emergence of the Antichrist, what we've talked about, with how short his dominance will be, just 3.5 years, before the Lord destroys him by his coming, I conclude that at no time do we ever have warrant to say with confidence that the Lord is more than a few years away, say 5 or 6 years, and it could be much shorter. God's sovereignty over the Antichrist and the final apostasy in the church should guard us from thinking we know how long it will take for these events to transpire. And as Jesus said, to presume upon certain delay is suicidal folly. I am not saying the Lord will come within 5 or 6 years. We do not know. I'm saying no one can legitimately say with confidence that he cannot or is not coming in such a short time or even shorter. So Piper's looking out. He's seeing these signs and he's saying the Lord could be back this soon. 5 or 6 years and these things could unfold in our midst under God's sovereignty. And so as we read this, we say, let us not be alarmed, but let us be alert. Let's watch for the signs that God has given us as we think about the end of the age. Here's the second thing I want to say. The second thing, one is we're alert to the signs. That's why Jesus gave them to us. Secondly, my second point is this, learn to rejoice in suffering. Learn to rejoice in suffering. Here's how Peter says this. Dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you, as something strange were happening to you. But rejoice inasmuch as you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. See what Peter's saying? He's talking about the coming of Christ. He's saying, don't be surprised if you suffer. Right? Jesus has told us there's going to be suffering. He's given us the times for God's people when we might suffer. He's saying, don't be surprised as if something strange was happening to you. It's like a warning. Don't say, oh, wow, how'd this happen? No, we've been told about the potential suffering and persecution of God's people. And we're told to rejoice in that, knowing that if we receive great suffering in eternity one day, we receive great glory from God. Suffering leads to glory. Now, some of you have asked me about this, or you know I've taught on this before. My view as I read Scripture is that all believers who are alive go through this 7-year tribulation period. We go through it. We experience the tribulation. We're not saved or removed from this tribulation time. I think if you read the book of Thessalonians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, just read those through, an honest reading of those two books, you will come to the conclusion that Paul in those books is talking about one coming of Christ. Not two different comings in the two different books, but one coming at the end of the age where Christ comes and puts all things right. I know this morning the view that Christians go through the tribulation is not a very emotionally satisfying view. Right? It doesn't make us feel happy. I often joke with people is I get a vote, I'd vote for something else. It's not an emotionally satisfying view, but I believe it is the biblically accurate view. But even if it's not the case, then let me just show you this second verse here in 2 Timothy. Here's what it says. Everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. So here's whether we could debate whether Christians face this final intense suffering, but here's what the Bible clearly says. To be a follower of Christ, you will be persecuted. And we know in this world, because it's a broken world, we face suffering. What a great billboard for come to Christ, right? You want to live for Jesus? Just know you're going to be persecuted. This is what the Bible is clearly telling us. I think part of my job description as pastor here, it's not officially written in, but part of my job description is to prepare us all to suffer well. That's my job. That we would so love Christ and see him better than anything else in this world, that whatever suffering might come our way, we just might say, I'm ready. I'm ready. The things of this world don't mean much to me. Christ, all the allurements and everything else, I just want more of Christ. So it's my job to prepare us to suffer well. Now, some of you might say, prepare us to... So that's true of all of us. Now, some of you might say, we're going to be prepared to suffer well, and then we're going to miss the final exam. Hey, I'd love that. That'd be great. But if it's not the case, and we go through the final exam, then might we be prepared to suffer well? And might, even if we were to go through the final time of suffering, the final tribulation, wouldn't our hearts be, Christ, what a privilege you have given us of all the people in the world to experience the worst persecution ever for the name of Christ. May we do your name worthy. May we stand strong and show how wonderful you are in the most difficult of times. Harbor, may that be our heart cry. Learn to rejoice in our suffering. Maybe some of you are going through a real difficult time right now. You're just weary and worn out, and you're like, why is this happening? Just keep hanging on to Christ. He's better. He's good. Keep hanging on to him. We're going to get here to the hope in the end. Hang on to him. Here's the third thing. It comes from Matthew 24 again. As Jesus is saying these words, he wraps it up this way. You'll see it on the screen. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. This is from the ESV. NIV says, be ready, I think, but ESV says it so much better. Stay awake. Stay awake. You could read what I've said. Or read the John Piper quote and say, okay, so Christ could come 5, 6 years or maybe 3, 4. So I got time. I got time. Well, I got lots of time. Then I'll get ready later on. I don't need to act now. That's why this word is so good. Stay awake. Stay awake spiritually. Don't fall asleep. See, Jesus is saying stay awake so you see the signs. But if you fall asleep, you're going to be asleep spiritually. You will miss the signs. And plus, the Antichrist is going to come and have supernatural, potentially, or supernaturally and for sure, satanic power to take sleeping people, sleeping souls captive. And so as we read these things, it should not be, oh, I've got a little bit of time. It should be, Lord, help keep my eyes spiritually awake. Help me live for you in these moments so I don't miss out on any of these things. And so as you might be here today or watching online, if you've not lived for Christ in the last month or the last year, this would just be a call. Come back to him now. Live for him now. Rouse yourself spiritually to follow him with all of your heart. If you've never turned from your sin and never trusted in Christ, if these things can scare you, they can terrify you, but wouldn't you come to Christ now and know you are safe in his presence and that he forgives all sin and welcomes us into eternity with him? These are the three ways the New Testament tells us to prepare. Be alert, be ready, learn to rejoice in suffering, and then stay awake spiritually. And then lastly, let me just come where we started, to the hope of the end. This can feel weighty, but then this is the end of the age, and what happens next? Christ returns on a cloud with a trumpet call, and then Daniel gives us this picture of what the end will look like. You'll see it on the screen, the six things that Daniel mentioned. The first three are the removal of negative. The last three are the increase of positive, or the adding of positive. Transgression is to be finished. You have these moments where you're like, I'm just not the person I want to be. This is not the man or the woman that I want to be. And this prophecy says in one day, all of your transgression, all of your sin is going to be finished. It's going to be gone. It's going to be taken away, and you're going to be exactly the person that God made you to be. Won't that be a wonderful day where no sin affects us? And then, secondly, there will be an end made to all sin. He will put an end to all sin, not just your life, but think of the whole global world. Think of all the people, and all their sin is going to be ended. Won't that be wonderful? Think of the relationships we will have with so many others where sin is finally judged and taken away. The third one there, an atonement will be made for wickedness. This happened on the cross, but it will be finally recognized that all our sin is going to be paid for, our guilt taken away, our transgressions covered. Those are the three things that are gone, all of sin. What enters in? An everlasting righteousness. There will be a kingdom of righteousness. The government will be on his shoulders. And the world will be as it should be. Vision and prophecy will come to an end, will be no more. Why is that going to happen? Because every prophecy will be fulfilled, and we will be able to encounter God face to face, as Revelation tells us. And lastly, they will anoint a most holy place. There will be a place of true and lasting worship for us, where we're in the presence of God. This is the picture of the end that should fill our hearts. This is what Daniel saw, and even though he saw this pain and suffering and potential persecution, he saw this vision of the end, and he said, oh God, this is where he rests our hearts, and this today is where we come to rest our hearts. About 10 years ago, I knew it was going to come, but someone on Facebook friended me, and I didn't know who he was, but I thought I'm going to accept the friend request because he was from a country called Myanmar, or Burma, as you may know it. It's now called Myanmar. I worked in Chicago at a church called Judson, and Judson, Adoniram Judson, was the first missionary to Myanmar. So I've always sort of had a place in my heart for this country, and so when this guy sent the friend request, I accepted it. We had a little chat some 10 years ago, and I said, oh, have you heard of Adoniram Judson? And he said, oh, everyone in Myanmar has heard of Adoniram Judson. He's our great-great-grandfather of all the churches, and so just encouraged me just to hear sort of a real-life testimony. And that probably would have been the end of the story. But this young man at the time, studying in Bible school in India, if I was giving him an award, I would give him an award of all of my Facebook friends as the very best Facebooker of all of them, of all my friends. He's just outstanding on Facebook. He's got a real skill to it. He posts regularly. He combines well video and story and words and live. He does a really nice job. If you wanted to study someone who does great at Facebooking, he's at the top of my list. And so over 10 years, I've really gotten to know him quite well. Not because of anything, of any relationship, just because I enjoy watching his Facebook feeds. It's like reality TV to some degree. And so I've just sort of watched his journey as a Bible school student to come back to Yangon, the capital of Myanmar, to start an orphanage there. He translates the Bible into some dialects, but his real passion has been to start a children's home. You'll see on the side screen there, my friend there on the left with his older daughter. And then you see as he started this orphanage, this children's home, some of the children there, a picture taken this year. So I've sort of enjoyed this whole journey with him. Right, seeing the children's home start, and at times praying, putting on Facebook, we don't have any money for food, we don't have any money for rent, and God's just been so faithful to meet him in so many ways. Then we see him get married, and I prayed for his wife, knowing that she'd have to feed all of these children and the stress of that, and then they had their first daughter, and then 2021 came. And in 2021, a couple of things happened in his life. One is COVID has come. And you know some of the fear that we faced at moments, but just imagine in a place where there is not good information. And all of these children are locked in this very small home, fearing COVID. And the posts from him, because he is so authentic and real, were just so full of fear and so full of worry. And they couldn't get good medical care, and they couldn't leave the house, and they couldn't find food. It was just such a difficult time for them. And then in the midst of all of that, some of you know what's happened in Myanmar over the last 2 years. There was this military coup. There was going to be some democratic elections. The military came in, imprisoned the president. She hasn't been seen since. And there's rioting in the streets. There's civil war. The government army is slaughtering people from ethnic tribes. Christians are taking some brunt of that and persecution and punishment. So in the middle of COVID, they released prisoners from the jail to try to stop all the civil war, just so there would be chaos everywhere and no one would protest. All this is going on. And here he is trying to have this orphanage and the fear of COVID and civil war, and you just feel like everything is falling apart for him. And then in the midst of that, his wife was pregnant with their second child. And she gave birth to the second child. But then over the next couple of weeks, we got these reports that she wasn't doing well. And he was always pretty positive and pray for my wife. And then one day I got up in the morning and I looked and he posted, and it was a real shock to me. His wife had died. I think just all the stress and all the pain of all they'd gone through, all the worry and all, you know, the access to medical care. His wife had died, and he posts this. He's on Facebook Live, and he's just crying from the bottom of his heart, the loss of his wife. You know, he's seeing his country deteriorate, all the fears of COVID. What do I do with my ministry? What do I do with the kids? He just let it all out. It was like I was watching the book of Job on Facebook Live, right before my eyes. He's just losing everything. And again, he's just posting, and this is the way I've come to know him over 10 years. And so then over the next couple of months, we just saw his grief just sort of spill out online, just in such deep and profound ways. And he grieved so well, but he grieved so deeply. And I just want to give you a sense of some of the things he wrote. He wrote this: COVID and the coup is killing people every day in Myanmar. Prisoners who were recently released are spreading around our city and across Myanmar. The ambulances have come into our area and tried to burn houses. They were stealing ambulances, burning homes. The thieves are also involved. Every day is heartbreaking in Myanmar. No news is good. Pastors and my friends have gone to be with the Lord every day. I can't believe my wife has died. I have no words to comfort myself. Only thing I can say is, honey, you prefer to rest in the arms of Jesus, and that is good for you, but it's heartbreaking for us. I hug her and touch her and say, honey, goodbye. I will see you in heaven. And then he wrote these words, I'm deeply thinking and missing you, especially these days. I hate life. I hate life without you. It's so hard. You just don't know. And we're just seeing his pain. You can just feel it, eh? Just being poured out over Facebook. And it was in these moments, then as he begins to write these next things, that I really understood from him what it means to hope in Christ. Here was his final paragraph in one post. Not only in Myanmar, but also the world is suffering. From north to south, to east, to west, the whole world is suffering. We believers know this. We know of the suffering, the wars, the famines, the diseases. And then he writes this, let us not fear. Let us not be shaken. But let us awake and prepare the way of the Lord. Let us not fear. Let us not be shaken. Let us not awake and prepare the way for the Lord. And what I so appreciated and what I so learned from him as I was watching this journey unfold, here he's been stripped of everything, right? He loses his wife. He's got these two young daughters. His country is falling apart. COVID is killing people. He's just lost everything. But yet what flows out of him is the only thing I've got is Christ in his return. Let's stand strong. Let's prepare the way for the Lord. And I learned something from him about what it means to hope in the Lord. May God create that kind of hope in us as a church harbor. Let me pray for us this morning. God, we thank you for the example of my friend in Myanmar who stayed faithful to you in the midst of everything. And we thank you for his vision of Christ and his faithfulness. And oh God, we pray, Lord, we pray that you would plant in us the same thing. Plant in us a desire to not fear, to not be shaken, to stay awake, and ultimately long for and prepare for the way of the Lord. God, may you fill us with that hope, we pray. And we pray this all in the name of Christ. Amen. And amen. Let me just, before we dismiss, we usually dismiss every service with four words. Let me just give a couple of updates, a couple of little reminders, and then I'll have you stand and we'll go. This Wednesday night, responding biblically to medical assistance in dying. Going to be a great night as we just process that. Please join me back here on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. And then today, in about 15 minutes, our welcome class starts. All our staff is going to be back there. I'll be back there. We would love to greet you, so please make your way back to the dock. If you think to pray for me this week, I'm a couple days in Quebec. We have a partnership there, so going to encourage Quentin. He's also sort of filled up my schedule with some training, some consulting, lots of different things. So if you thought to pray for me, I'm looking forward to being with Quentin and really seeing how through Harbor we can continue to further the work there in Montreal. Can I just invite you to stand as we might close our service? In Revelation 20, we get this picture of the suffering saints of Jesus. And then Christ honoring them. And then it says this, they came back to life, all who were persecuted. They came to life and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. It's a wonderful picture looking forward through the persecution, but there's this great resurrection and reigning with Christ. Harbor, may we fill our hearts with that hope today. Harbor, we are sent.